The main idea of the paper is that there has been a lot of talks about macroprudential policy, both in research and in academic research and in models and in policy initiatives. But and there are new prudential measures in the United States, in Europe, and in emerging markets. But if you wanna analyze an episode of macroprudential policy that has taken over a full credit cycle with granular data to analyze the issues, Spain offers one that started in 2000, and we analyzed basically from 1999 to 2013 what happened in Spain with this particular macroprudential countercyclical bank capital buffers policies. And the main motivation is the banking crisis, which started here in the States and in the Western Europe, and triggered a deep and long-lasting recession. These banking crises are not a unique phenomenon, but they repeat over time. And the main channel by which a financial crisis, within a financial crisis, one of the main channels that can affect the economy at large is through a reduction in the credit supply, like in the paper by Bernanke over the Great Depression. But not only the crisis matters, but also if you analyze this financial crisis, the main correlate ex ante of the financial crisis throughout history is credit booms. Therefore, financial crises are not endogenous phenomena, exogenous phenomena. You need to understand a bit the credit booms and the credit busts, that is to analyze credit cycles, and cycles in the sense of the low frequency, before the crisis and after the crisis. Once you analyze credit cycles, of course, there could be that credit cycles just follow good economic fundamentals driven by demand, or it could be also some financial frictions, demand driven. For instance, that, like in the Kiyotaki Moore, through the collateral, the change in asset and real estate prices, you can change the value of collateral, the credit availability of borrowers, and therefore have implications for the economy. We are more interested in the supply side, that is, frictions at the bank level, changes in bank capital and liquidity, how these can increase the supply of credit or reduce the supply of credit. Now, if we think about the credit supply cycles, in the bad times, it's clear that many banks enter into the crisis with little capital. This creates problems of getting funding liquidity for the banks, and therefore they might reduce the supply of credit for borrowers. In the good times, it might be the case that capitals have little skill in the game, little capital at stake, and they do not internalize fully the actions that they take. Okay? They soften sometimes too much the lending standards. Now, macroprudential policy, what it's trying to do is to basically not take each bank in isolation or each financial institution in isolation, but to take the whole of the financial institutions and the implications from the financial system to the real sector. For instance, microprudential will tell you that in the middle of the crisis, you need to increase capital ratios. But they don't care whether you increase equity or you decrease total assets. But if you decrease total assets, basically, you are deleveraging. One way of deleveraging is reducing the credit supply in the economy. And this might have implications for companies, for unemployment, for investments, and things like that. So macroprudential would take all these things into account. Now, if you follow these papers by, for instance, Jordashul, Alec Taylor, and others, or Kindleberger, if you follow throughout financial history, the main correlate has been credit cycles. So credit cycles are time-varying. There are booms and busts. Therefore, you need tools of macroprudential that vary over the cycle. And one of the proposed ones in the literature, both in Basel III, the president here, or the chairman of the Fed, or papers, academic papers like the Watribod and Tirol, are these, for instance, countercyclical bank capital buffers, which is procyclical capital and provisioning requirements, higher in good times, softer in bad times, such that when you arrive to a bust, you have a buffer, because there is a softening with the crisis, okay? Now, if you have these two, potentially they could be useful. Why is that? Because in the good times, you will have higher requirements. Therefore, you might internalize better your decisions in lending. In the bad times, when you enter into the bad times, you will enter with higher capital buffers. And therefore, you can get that funding liquidity without less need of the government help, okay? Now, what we pursue is, what is the general question is, what is the impact of macroprudential policy on credit supply cycles is an empirical paper and the externalities to the real sector. And in particular, what is the effect of this countercyclical bank capital buffer, procyclical capital provision requirements on the supply of credit and on firm real effects in good and in bad times? Yeah, since it's capital, just let me say briefly that there is all these different rationales of incentives, buffers, are highlighted in theoretical models. Of course, some theoretical models have different testable implications, so it's not clear what the effects should be in the real world. Now, not only academics care about this, but policymakers. Capital regulation has been the central regulation for prudential policy since the 80s. Now, when they started with Basel I, now in Basel III, there is one part, which is this contracyclical bank capital buffers. Okay, so that they will increase the capital requirements when credit is sufficiently higher than GDP. Just one slide on the bankers. The bankers, just Joseph Ackermann, the CEO, the former CEO of Deutsche Bank, just to say that what the bankers complain is just the following thing. They say that for these capital requirements are good for stability, financial stability, but there is a trade-off. This will increase the cost of capital for the banking sector. It will be translated to the real economy, and there will be less economic growth. Therefore, it's for academic, for policymakers, and for, in a sense, for market participants, it's interesting this question on countercyclical bank capital buffers, on credit supply cycles, and real effects in good and bad times. Let me say that what we do in this paper is the following. We do average effects. So what is the change in credit supply for the average effect? Then at the bank level and at the loan level. Then since firm can substitute from less affected banks, from banks which are not regulated, we analyze at the firm level whether firms can truly neutralize these shocks. This is for the average effects. Then we also analyze heterogeneity at the bank level. Are banks with riskier are gonna have the same implications? We also analyze heterogeneity at the firm level. Are you gonna have a search for yield? Are banks gonna substitute, are gonna increase risk in order to increase the yield, to increase profits? And in a sense, undo part of the policy objective. And finally, since it is about macroprudential, what we care is about real effects. So we will analyze the real effects on firm assets, employment, and survival. Now, if we want to do this, you need two things for an empirical paper. You need the policy changes, a full credit cycle, because this is about good and bad times. And you need, since these macroprudential policy are not randomized experiments, you need very granular data in order to disentangle demand and supply and to analyze the different margins of lending. Okay, in particular, these real effects, compositional effects, for instance, search for yield, risk-taking, and things like that. Now, Spain is useful. So our paper is about Spain. Spain is useful because it has the two things. It has these policy initiatives on countercyclical bank capital buffers. It's about the so-called dynamic provisioning. I mean, I don't have here like a blackboard, but basically, if you think like in normal times around the world, there is a paper by Levin and Mahoney that shows that provisioning is close to zero. Zero, zero, zero in good times. And then it jumps massively in bad times. When you jump massively in bad times is the moment provisioning, you get it from the shareholder own funds. But in that particular moment in bad times, profits, bank profits are negative. And access to markets, to equity markets, is very costly. And therefore, this high cost, you are gonna pass it to the borrowers. So the dynamic provisioning, what it tries to do is not to be zero in the good times, to make it higher in the good times, such that when you enter into the crisis, you don't need to increase so much. That's the idea. I will put later a chart showing these things. There was five policy different shocks. The introduction was in 2000, was a tightening, an introduction ex novo of the policy. There is the crisis. Spain has this credit register. All the business loans are there, matched with firm and bank level data. And basically, we do a difference in difference at the loan and firm level, both with credit and real variables. What we find, let me just give you a preview of the results. What we find is that they change the incentive. So basically, a tightening of prudential regulation, banks more affected, they start reducing credit supply. And when there is the crisis and they have these more buffers built up in the good times, they can give more credit supply in the crisis. Okay? This is at the loan level, which is at the bank level, bank firm. Now firms, what happens to firms? Firms in good times, they can substitute. This is the data what is telling us. They can substitute and they neutralize the effects. They are very short-lived. They last for one quarter. Whereas in crisis times, they cannot substitute. The granting of loan applications dramatically falls. Going to a new bank is very difficult. And this implies that the results are binding at the firm level, and then you have a strong elasticities. I will describe later, I will give you the elasticities, a strong elasticities on employment, firm assets, and firm survival. Now, these provisions were only 1% of total assets. They were very small. I mean, they are. I mean, if you think about in Europe, equity over total assets is 4%. So in a sense, relative to equity, they are not small. But relative to the total assets, they are very small. So they were depleted. At the end of 2010, they were depleted. So then there was a new shock, which is basically they introduce new provisions in the middle of the crisis with the new government. This introduction created like a credit crunch and firm debt. So increasing these provisions in the middle of the crisis created like a credit crunch. So it seems that it is better, it seems, at least you save if you increase it before the crisis. All of this is at the average level. Now, if you find heterogeneity, there are several margins of heterogeneity which are interesting. First one, which we guess is an intended consequence of policy, is that when there is the tightening of prudential policy, there is a reduction in profits for the banks and a reduction in the supply of credit. Banks compensate by taking on higher risk. Basically, they move to firms with higher leverage and with higher ex-ante yields. This is what the data tell us. Then when you soften in the crisis, sometimes you soften the requirements of capital in the crisis to push a credit, but sometimes banks don't do it because if they are very risky, they have like a market constraint. So sometimes policy is ineffective in the sense that there is like a market constraint there that does not allow the bank to push on credit supply. So now I will go to the policy shocks more in detail, fast on the empirical strategy, and then the results that I will focus here is in the 2000 and in the crisis, and then I will conclude. Basically, this was introduced in 2000 for the Bank of Spain. The Bank of Spain, the central bank, not only is the supervisor of the banking sector, but is also responsible of accounting. These provisions are forward-looking in the sense, as I explained before, they are thinking that whenever there is a crisis, you will need to increase a lot of specific provisions. So basically, what you do is this countercyclical policy, which is you build the buffer today, and you can release it when the crisis arrives. There are five policy shocks, the introduction in 2000, a modification in 2005, a floor lower in 2008 and 2009. Basically, you build a buffer. When you build a buffer, there is like a ceiling, not so that you don't build massively. But let me just say this is important, is for all the banks, except for the foreign banks, foreign bank branches. So foreign bank subsidiaries are affected by the policy. Foreign bank branches are not affected for the policy. And there is a move from the regulated sector to the unregulated sector. So it's like a shadow banking system, in a sense. This is the formula. These are flows. So general provisions of bank I in quarter T is the flow in this, the change in provisions, the flow in that period. The formula, so what is, was introduced was this thing here. Here, this one. Basically, this is the specific provisions of this bank in this particular moment. This is the level of loans that the bank has. And beta is the average of the provisions over the whole cycle, calculated on the previous cycle. So this is dynamic in the following sense. In good times, this guy here is very low, no? Specific provisions is very low. We know that around the world. This is very low. Since this will be the average over a business cycle, this number will be higher. And therefore, you start building up. You start building up. No? So the current provisions are lower than the average. The current provisions are lower than the average of the cycle. And then you start building up a buffer. Okay, you build up a buffer, and the stock of the buffer has a ceiling and a floor. The floor will be removed from 33% to 10%, and from 10% to zero in the middle of the crisis. In bad times, is the opposite. In bad times, specific provisions are very high, higher than the average of the cycle. Over the cycle will be the average, no? So in the crisis, it will be higher. Therefore, you can, then the flows can be negative. So the stock will be reduced. You can use this that you save in the good times to, in, you know, to fund the specific provisions of that particular period. And this is related. So basically, the latent loss will be is this alpha, which is calculated previous on the previous cycle, and it doesn't change. It doesn't change. But let me say that there was, so let me say here, so these are the flows. This was the introduction, it jumped. In 2005, there was a softening. So in 2005, you know, there basically there were 5 years in a row building up provisions, and in that moment, there was a new regulation of, on softening. Okay, just 2 years before the crisis. So, and I mean, Anil will talk about this. So there was a softening on this. But if you see the softening, it's like a dip. Immediately it was recovered, but there was a softening. Here on the stocks, let me explain well this one. These are the stocks of provisions. The red is the specific provisions. This is what I was telling you before. In general case, it's close to zero, the specific provisions in good times. This is 98. And this is 2010, December 2010. Now, in the crisis, you're going to increase this massively, specific provisions. Now, the blue is the total provisions. As you see, the total provisions didn't increase as much as the specific provisions. The slope of the blue is flatter than the slope of the red. Why is that? Because what you build, which is the green, these dynamic provisions, you could go down. And you see, these are the stocks, the flows were negative. You could go down. That's the idea. You save on this particular moment in which bank profits are negative and access to equity markets is costly. But the last thing I want to say is look at here around the end of December 10. The blue and the red, the total provisions and the specific provisions are parallel now. Because you depleted the dynamic provisioning. And then after that, there was an increase in provisions, and that created a further credit crunch. Basically, FAST in empirical identification is just difference in difference. We compare the different policy shocks, the five, and the crisis. Banks more or less affected. The formula were identical to all the banks, but the formula depending on the credit portfolio. So banks, there were banks more affected and banks less affected by the different policy shocks. Moreover, in one part, we compare the banks regulated and the banks non-regulated. And in here, I'm going to show you the impact of the policy on credit and real effects. But we also do like a two-stage analysis. In the first stage, we analyze the impact of the policy on total provisions and how total provisions affect real and credit variables. We saturate all the regressions with firm fixed effects in order to compare at the loan level banks more affected and less affected lending to the same firm at the same time. We control for other bank characteristics. We do lots of robustness. Of course, I cannot have time here. Different samples. And the main variable that we are going to analyze is lot credit commitment, but we also analyze price, collateral, maturity, drawn, and heterogeneity in credit supply, and real effects. Okay? The data is from the credit register. There are absolutely all the business loans in Spain at quarterly frequency. There is also loan applications, and this is matched with firm and bank level data. Between each bank and a firm, there will be maybe several loans. We collapse all the different loans between a bank and a firm in a particular quarter. That will be our level of analysis. We include 1 year and a half before the first policy shock to see pre-trends in the data, like placebo test. And we have several years of the crisis until 2013 Q3. As I said before, we analyze the main variable is credit commitment and the real effects. We analyze the introduction in 2000, which is basically based on a formula. And so different banks will be differently affected. Then there is the floor lower in 2008 Q4 and 2009 Q4, which will be for the banks closer to the floor. Then there is the unexpected crisis, which should be in a sense, bands with higher dynamic, ex-ante dynamic provision buffers will be, they could release more buffers, softer more the requirements in the crisis. And finally, since there were the, these denied provisions were depleted, there was an increase in provision in 2012 Q1, and this was based on real estate exposure. So this increase in provision will be stronger for banks with higher real estate exposure, and we analyze that on the supply of credit to non-real estate firms. The question is the change in lot commitment between bank B and firm B on the change in dynamic provisioning that I described in the previous slide, and we put these firm fixed effects. These are the different margins that we analyze on the left-hand side of lending and real effects, and we have a lot of controls. If I have time on the discussion, then I will tell you all the robustness. At the firm level, we analyze the same thing at the firm level. At the firm level, the difference is this thing, which is basically dynamic provisioning will be the banks that were lending to me ex ante, they were differently affected. I take the average of those ones, and this is how the average bank that was lending to me before the shock, how that is going to affect me on credit supply. If I can change, it doesn't matter how much they were affected ex ante my banks, because I can switch to another one. So this will be very important, whether switching is easy or not. Because if it is easy, I can go, for instance, in the string case to the unregulated part and undo the shock. This is the introduction. Let me just put you the results in charts. This is the introduction in 2000 Q3. This is the coefficients. This is 99 Q2, and this is 2003 Q4. This was the introduction here in June 2000. Okay, and this is the coefficients of the regression between the change in lot commitment and the change in the dynamic provisioning. Okay, so it's negative after the introduction. I will tell you later on the elasticities. It's negative and it's not affected before. So basic, and this is at the loan level. Banks more affected by the policy reacted by reducing the supply of credit to the same firm as compared to banks less affected. This is at the loan level. If I show you the coefficients in blue at the firm level, you see that at the firm level is between the zero and the black, which is the loan level. So they substitute. And if you see, basically they substitute massively. In after 1-2 quarters, the coefficient is totally zero. So basically, firms could go to banks less affected or unregulated and neutralize the shock. This is the good times. The crisis, I want to show you in the crisis three things. One is how much you enter into the crisis. This is the buffer you enter to the crisis. You have both the loan level effects in black and in blue, the firm level effects. The more buffers you enter into the crisis, the more credit supply you give in the crisis. You see that firms can substitute somewhat. So the firm level is between zero and the loan level, but they are binding. Substitution is tricky in the crisis. We show this with loan applications as well. This is the granting of loan applications. So in the granting of loan applications to new banks that the borrower is not borrowing from, it decreases massively in the crisis. So these strong effects are going to have implications for real effects, and the elasticities are the following one. If you decrease these buffers by 1%, 1.17%, the credit commitment at the firm level, decreases by 6%, total assets by 3%, total employment, which is important for Spain, 3% for the surviving firms, but 1% of the firms die. And also you help borrowers which are currently not borrowing from you. There is two floor lowering. Apart from this, in the middle of the crisis, there was two floor lowerings of this provision. These floor lowerings, that is to allow banks to use all these dynamic provisions, imply this in the precise moments in which the floor was lower, imply an increase in the supply of credit. Then this dynamic provision, as I explained in that chart, they depleted. The new government introduced new provisions. And what we find is that these new provisions, both at the firm level and at the bank, at the firm level and at the loan level, they decrease the supply of credit by 20%, and this led to an increase in firm debt. We cannot have employment here because this data goes until 2013 Q3, and there is no unemployment data yet. Heterogeneous effects I already said at the beginning, so let me skip it. But this part is very important: the heterogeneous effects. Our intended contribution is, why Spain? Spain just because it has the policy over a full credit cycle, and it has the data in order to at least understand something. It's not the first paper we do with this data, but the other papers were related to monetary policy. And macroprudential policy matters in different ways. And the last slide, just let me say, with any normative, no normative statement, just what we get from here. You can modify the credit supply. The main real effects are gonna come in crisis times because of these substitution effects across financial. There is the quantification of elasticities. Of course, elasticities are never, even in this setting, they depend heterogeneously on banks and firms. So they are not universal elasticities, okay? But at least we have this quantification of the elasticities here. There are unintended consequences of policy. In this case, that there was an increase in risk taking when it was the tightening, initial tightening. Heterogeneity is crucial. So in the crisis stance, we show that not only matters the aggregate bank capital in the economy, but how it is distributed. So heterogeneity in the bank level matters. Heterogeneity in the first also matters, because it matters, you change the borrowers, you change the composition of the supply of credit in the good times. Not only policy constraints, matter, but also market constraints. So sometimes you soften the standards, but there is not a push on credit supply because there is like a market constraint there. And the final thing is that it is costly, we find, and we find that it's costly to increase these requirements in bad times. I mean, it led in this data to a credit crunch and firm death. So it also points out not only macroprudential, but on this debate about bank capital, whether bank capital, no, is costly or is not costly. We find here that it's costly in bad times. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for including me in this conference. It's been very interesting. I actually reverse and talk a little bit about Spain and put some of the variation of the data in context, then talk a little bit about how dynamic provisioning works, and then pick out the results that I think are most interesting, and then talk about some questions. Okay, so just to set the parameters, the total numbers here in terms of provisioning, I think, are actually quite small. So they raised about a billion of extra loan loss provision. If my ability to navigate the Bank of Spain's website is correct, here's the units for how much borrowing this provisioning applied against. So it's like a factor of 100. I mean, the surge in corporate borrowing is astronomical, so it's like spitting into the ocean trying to stop this. I don't know what people think the lesson is, but I actually don't think we actually ran the experiment even, because the surge in lending was so big relative to what they were able to do. And I actually think one of the most interesting things is the fact that a lot of the losses came once the provisions topped out. If you actually look, part of what's going on here is they had a limit on how much people could be forced to build up in this buffer. And this happens in lots of cases. I mean, the FDIC had stopped collecting deposit insurance before the crisis, because they thought the buffer had become sufficiently full that we could never possibly use all that money. So this is a general thing that happens in these regulatory cases. So having the political support to be able to keep tying up funds when times are good is something that's very, very challenging. And I think that's one of the issues for this paper and pretty much anybody looking at Spain, because I think the motivation for looking at Spain is quite good. It's basically the only place anybody tried this. And then when you see what they actually did, it's kind of small. So whether you could actually do this in scale and convince the banks to go along without lobbying like crazy to get it undone, I think is a big question that's kind of important. If you look, in some sense, the last experiment where they talk about the housing is probably the most important, because if you look at when Spain really gets into trouble, it's when the house prices peak. It's not so much the corporate borrowing, but as soon as the house prices start falling, that's when the economy really starts deteriorating. And if you look at the condition of the banks now, probably the most important issue is how many unrealized bad housing loans or commercial real estate loans are sitting on the balance sheets and haven't been attended to. So in some sense, the policy angle here, I think, is more about housing and personal lending than maybe the corporate lending. One thing that is also important about Spain is they have recourse. So if you have a bad housing loan, so you borrowed up there at the peak and now you've seen your house price deteriorate by 30%, you're going to carry that debt forever in principle unless they suspend that rule. Okay, so he didn't show you the actual formula so much, but in fact, it's more complicated than the one that was displayed because there's six different types of loans. So to answer Fernando's question, partly the reason you're going to have a big stock is going to depend on the line of business that you were in beforehand. And if you happen to be in a commitment-intensive business, you will have been forced to bid up your provisions. Now, one weird thing about bank accounting is how a loan loss actually works. So when you make a provision, what you end up doing is putting an asset with a negative number on the asset side of your balance sheet. And then when you recognize the loss, you draw down that provision and you draw down the loan. So on recognition, there's nothing that happens on the accounting statements. It's on entry when you add to the loan loss that you actually do anything. So one very interesting question is why, you know, when they did this policy easing here in 2005, the reason they shoot up is because people end up binding against that constraint. I think to put this in context, the reason why they're working on this is there are all these questions that we don't really know about. So the regulators have this sense. So the paper starts out talking about countercyclical regulatory tools. And I think it is true that the place where the regulations have changed the most thus far is on this countercyclical angle. So the Basel Committee has rushed ahead with capital regulation. They're going to eventually do something about liquidity, but the thing that they've actually institutionalized is exactly this countercyclical provisioning. And the theory there is that if you can push against the boom in good times, the bust will be less important. And I think that is a critical consideration. The question is just, will you have the kind of institutional and political support to really lean? I mean, if you look at how much lending was going on, this maybe it slowed it down, but it sure didn't do it by very much. And so I think if you're going to achieve the macro prudential objective, you have to be prepared to do pretty aggressive interventions into the banking system. And in most countries like the US, we have no history of doing that. I mean, we let the banks pay dividends well into 2008. Now, if you were going to do one thing to try to build up capital, it wouldn't be something about provisions. You'd just shut off dividends because banks pay dividends out like crazy at all times. And there was no political support. When you talk to regulators, they mostly say, how can I go tell a solvent business that's in compliance with the regulations that they can't pay dividends? So if you can't get over that, I don't know if there's anything more that you can do. But that would be a more direct way to do it, and I don't think that we have, any evidence to suggest you could do this on a big scale. And then the second thing that you have to worry about, which I think is going to be a big issue going forward, is the more expensive we make it for banks to operate, the more incentive there is to move stuff out of the banking system, like we talked about yesterday. I mean, we're layering all these regulations on the banks and doing essentially nothing to the outside option. And so the creation of more of these special purpose vehicles and funny funding arrangements that are just pure regulatory arbitrage, I think, is going to go way, way up. All right, so, you know, my take is that they find that there is a little bit of constriction in corporate lending when the provisions go up. It's a little bit asymmetric, that the firms appear to be able to substitute in good times, but in bad times there's a persistent shock. Okay, so that's the way the paper's pitched. I think it's kind of hard to know how to interpret the regressions. And so I actually think that this is a case where development economics is polluted macro. The kind of corporate culture and development economics is difference and difference and difference, and get the identification police to come and make sure that you've got clean variation. These guys are responding to that incentive. But when you think about what happens and how you're identifying the stuff, your head starts to hurt. So imagine that this is what the data actually look like. So the only place I've ever done anything like this is I've looked at the Italian credit register data, and I don't know if you guys have ever done this, but if you look in Italy, what happens is, remember that the variation that they're trying to use is two banks lending to the same firm and then looking at a shock. Okay, so think about when the two banks are going to be lending to the firm, what you're identifying off of. So imagine that what you've got is a line of credit from one bank that's, you know, this much at a given interest rate. Then you have another bank that's given another line of credit, probably at a higher interest rate, and then there's another one. And so if you think about what the bank is actually doing when it's making its borrowing decision, it's going to exhaust the cheapest one, then it's going to exhaust the next cheapest, and so on. And you know, I actually did calculations like this with the Italian data and found that the firms kind of walk up the supply curve. Okay, now, that all makes sense. And if you think that the nature of the shock that they're looking at kind of shifts these things up by more or less the same amount, then the new supply curve is going to look like those dashed lines, and maybe you're going to intersect it there. The thing that they're trying to identify off of is, you know, did we get equal increases in these? It's kind of a maintained assumption that the supply curve shifts up in kind of a parallel fashion. But what happens if it's like this, where the increase doesn't respect the initial supply curve, in which case you would want to switch and use these two before you use the one that used to be cheaper? I think if we're going to really make sense of this, you have to show us exactly how these things are changing so that we can interpret what actually happened. And this is where the development economics, that the phrase that's in every one of these papers is, I have saturated the regression with fixed effects. And by the time you've done that, I have no idea what you've actually identified off of. So I think it would be helpful to go back and do something much more simple, because you look and the regressions naturally change quite a bit depending on which fixed effects you're in there. And I think they should, but it's not clear which of this kind of variation you think is reasonable or not. So I think that's the biggest challenge. And as soon as you start doing that, then you start wondering about why do they differ in the first place? Why are they borrowing from multiple banks? And then, you know, can we aggregate these effects and say that they would be the same in response to other shocks? So I think this is an interesting data set. I've got at least three papers they've written that I wish I'd been able to write using these data, and I think this one has a chance to get there, but I think they need to be able to show us a little bit more about the identification. And then I think there should be more discussion about this political economy stuff, of the history about why they relaxed these constraints and tightened them, and why the levels are so small, and whether or not we can do this. One thing to keep in mind that he didn't say is the only reason Spain was able to do this is because they didn't do GAAP. GAAP accounting doesn't allow you to do this, because the accountants have announced to the world that if you provision generally against a loan and you can't point to why the loss is coming, that's a slippery slope towards earnings management. So if you're going to use this tool, the first thing you have to do is throw out gap. Now, I don't know whether there'll be political support for doing that. There are big issues with gap accounting, but there's all kinds of hornet's nests like that lurking if we're really going to lean on this tool. All right, thanks.
Many thanks, Anil, for the discussion and for the comments. Let me start in reverse order. So on this identification on the firm fixed effects, in the paper, like in the previous paper, we show the results without these fixed effects. And in fact, the coefficient doesn't change at all. The main coefficient, for instance, in the 2000 is around 0.35. Without the fixed effects, is 0.31. And we put that into the, so we do that. Eh? I mean, we show it with the fixed effects, without the fixed effects, with observable characteristics.
I'm not sure that's good.
No. We show in all that way. Then think about loan applications. What does it mean, a fixed effect in a loan application? In a loan application means I apply to different banks, and which bank is granting me the application? That is what the fixed effect is doing. Is I apply to different banks, and which bank is giving me the application? That is what the fixed effect is doing in these loan applications that we show there. Then. Not only analyze credit in that case for this, but credit commitment, but all the different margins like drawn, collateral, commitment. Then you commitment, maturity, and price. So you can get that. Then on the small, true, it's very small. That's why they were depleted easily, and there was a big increase. There has to be a big increase in the middle of the crisis. Now for identification, I know that you are, for identification that is small is good. Now, for the country, of course, maybe is not good because they have to increase later on, and this created a credit crunch. For identification, it's good that it was small. But this is true. But equity over total assets is 4%. This was 1.25%. So it's small relative to total assets, true, but it's 25% of equity. So it was not so small as compared to equity. The migration of the banking, of the shadow banking sector, yes. So we show that they went to the other part, to the unregulated, to the less regulated part. Is that so? That's what the results show. If you want to do a better policy, maybe then if you want to implement the policy, you have to take into consideration that they will switch, especially in the good times. And finally, there is the 2005 shock. Of course, that was a softening. So they knew that the introduction in the crisis will lead to this softening, but what they didn't know and what they pushed is a softening in 2005. Spain became the country with the highest provisions in the whole OECD, and they decreased. But for an empiricist, that's an interesting shock to analyze. Now, our paper is not about optimal regulation. For optimal regulation, of course, you don't want a softening 2 years before the crisis. But for knowing more about the data, about what are the implications of this? For instance, we are showing that there was a search for yield. So for empirical stuff, it's interesting. Of course, for optimal policy, it might not be the best.
So is it possible to take a little bit longer time series perspective on this? I know in other countries people look at things like the credit cycle and business cycle and some very, very loose connections between the two, sometimes very little intelligence of financial crisis. Is there?
Yes.
When I think about macroprudential policy, I guess I have to think about that a little bit more systematically over time, I suppose.
Yes, there is these papers by Shularik, Taylor, Jordá, in which they analyze these 14 countries, now 17, over the last 140 years. And what they find is that these credit booms are the best correlate of financial crisis. And conditioned on a financial crisis, the worst real effects are coming with higher ex-ante credit booms. So these are the historical.
They are connected to financial crises. And so if you do countercyclical capital control, do you do it based on tobacco
performance? Or?
Yeah, but our data starts in 1984, yeah. There was a big one at the beginning of the 80s, yeah. So these are, in the data, I mean, we only have two recessions with our data.
I'm going to make a boring comment, but it is it use of proper, I mean, I'm kind of following up on Anil's observation that this recent results always have to be taken with a salt. If I'm thinking, like, it's very important when we think about this type of policy, what is the contractionary effect on credit that you get, for example, in normal times, when you're raising the provision. So it's a very important aggregate question, how much credit goes down because of this thing. One looks at your result, and your interpretation is, oh, we get zero because firms can subsidy. But of course, that's not what the data, that's not what your results say. Your results say, if I compare two firms that are exposed to different banks, the firm that is exposed to a bank that had to increase provision more has the same effect as the other firm. But it doesn't say that the general level of credit did not go down.
But you have it there. Exactly. But you have it there. Then in the loan level, you have it in the loan level regressions. The firms can substitute, but in the loan level regression, you see how. But the fixed effect. Exactly. But the fixed effects. We have like sometimes even 20 columns in the table. So you know, like in here, it's just a summary. We have regressions without all these effects, without the effects. And without. We also show results without the fixed effects, non-fixed effects. No fixed effects. And in that case, you see a contraction. That's why I said in the first of the takeaways from the paper is you can modify the credit supply. You can modify the credit supply in the good times, and they change it, the behavior.
So the level effect is?
Yeah, so.
One thing that always puzzled me during the Greek crisis when I was noticing what the banks were doing was that the best banks, as approved afterwards by the BlackRock audit that was done to them, it really went down to the nitty-gritty, the best banks were cutting credit even faster than the worst banks. And the simple explanation for this, once I asked one of the guys who's very high up with that bank, what you guys doing is basically keeping your gunpowder dry so you can buy up each other. Because there is like a big consolidation. Every single crisis where there was banking involved, there was a huge consolidation of the banking system afterwards. So rather than going and competing for individual creditors, just keep your gunpowder dry so you can buy the whole portfolio when the other bank comes up for sale.
Yeah, sometimes it turns out to be countrywide portfolio that you buy and got buyers there.
So I'm just wondering about the interpretation of these results. Like, you might even get the other thing that I meant to say is that this whole choosing of credit lines between banks, like, but that was another thing that we were talking to corporate CFOs before the crisis came. What we see them doing is go and open up credit lines with other banks. Why? Because there's something surprising in banking, which is they don't charge you an upfront fee, at least not at least, for opening up a credit line. The bank basically gives you the free option and only wins if you actually use it. It only gets that markup on it if you actually use it. So what this guy was doing was unbelievable. He was basically going around the banks and using a little bit of the credit line for a little bit of time. Because he was saying, I don't care about the rate you're gonna charge me for an extra couple of months. This is so much of a low charge for being able to keep the credit line alive. And he was worried that when the credit line was due to be renewed, because they're up for yearly renewal, if he didn't use the credit line for a little period of time, the bank would take it away. Mm-hmm. So he was basically paying for that option. Mm-hmm. To be honest, the way it happens is the relationship banker comes and tells you, look, use it a little bit, because when you come up for renewal, I want to be able to tell those people that you used it, so we made some money out of it. So the guy was pretty much randomly, going around and changing stuff. So all I'm trying to say, I'm a little bit with Anil here, but there is so much
But for instance, this, we analyze the commitment, the drone, and the drone overcommitted. How much over the committed you drone. And on the first question, is more on the interbank market. Yeah, there is sometimes predatory, You hold liquid in the interbank market to penalize the other banks. This lending in the interbank market is crucial.
The question was mostly a clarification question. How would that show up in your regressions? Would you pick that up? Suppose that the best bank, holds back so it can buy up the other banks.
But where the hell holds back? It holds back especially on the liquidity market, for the other banks. But this is lending to firms. So if I want, no, if you need liquidity, I will not pass you the liquidity bank to bank so that you don't get this liquidity, you fail, and then I can buy you up. But here are loans loans to firms, non-financial firms. Non-financial firms.
So you operate on both margins. Both trying, you know, to like increase, so to say, your liquid assets and at the same time. I agree with you on the first part, which is the first thing you do is you don't provide liquidity to other banks. You know, the treasurers in those banks immediately, you know, cut off other banks from interbank lending. Part of the reason why they all have to go to the ECB. But then, okay, that margin is well understood. What about the other margin of like I'm trying to restrict how much I give?
So in here, the best banks are the ones that lend more in the data. So in the data.
So just kind of ignorance, total ignorance on the kind of mind, but like, are there like enough banks that have like outstanding shares in, you know, like some of their, then you can see also the effect the regulations on their equity and whether these are like unexpected. But part of this on the other side is it should be good for them or not. So maybe this was discussed for 10 years or maybe it's only 10 months. I don't know. So that's one question. And then the other question is there something, I mean, you just hear like when you hear in radio or something, not really informed that it's kind of like we are looking type of bank to defend and motivation to Spain. It's kind of like a podcast.
Yeah.
Is it something that you use them because then the effect for them will be different? Because if I understand it from what you sort of hear in the radio or something, they really are not going to be trying to do, they don't have the same incentives in terms of, you know, sort of trying to have the same relationship, if I understand it correctly. They do crazy stuff for a different reason, not for a reason like that.
Yeah. So the crazy stuff was, as Anil was saying, on the real estate market, and this is on lending to non-financial firms. But in any case, because these things are, you never know. When I said robustness and different samples, in one of the samples we take out all these saving banks, all of them out, and we analyze the regressions.
What I thought would be interesting if you could explain us to.
But these cajas were the big boom that they got was on the real estate market, and we are not analyzing the real estate market. We are only analyzing the non-financial firms, and basically, and the main reason for that is that. If we want to analyze real effects, we are now trying to get all these household characteristics for another type of papers, but in here we have employment and survival of the firm. Whereas households, they cannot go bankrupt. There is no law, and in fact, the only way that they can go bankrupt is leave the country, which many left. Whereas in households, in firms, we have the death of the firm, the employment and things characteristics. Households, we don't have consumption, this type of thing. So that's why we don't analyze, which is very interesting, but this is a question of data, of real variables.
So do they pay dividends?
They pay. Now Santander, for instance, have paid a big dividend. So that's, there are other policies which will be very interesting, which is this one, or force the banks at the beginning. Here in Spain, 2008 and 9 was not so bad. It's when they depleted in 2010. So then if maybe the central bank should have forced the banks at that moment to raise equity. So there are other policies. The nice thing here is just to say, what are the results of these policies? Without normative, these are the results.
So dividends, like you were saying, what is the dividend relative to assets? What's the number?
Or relative to equity, it's a big deal.
No, but if you look, because your point.
No, right.
No, I realize, but
relative to assets is very small. I mean, Banco Santander has more than 1 trillion of total assets.
I think the U.S. So, banks paid out approximately the amount that they took from TARP from 2007 until they stopped. Eric Rosenberg has a bunch of like jaw-dropping calculations of this sort. But the two big Spanish banks weren't in trouble because they were in Latin America and they were the least exposed of the. So his identification's all off the cajas and the smaller guys, I guess. Right? I mean, they do some stuff in the paper where they throw out the big banks.
We throw out the last four banks just to see what the results are. We do many different sets of.
So when a bank is bought up by another bank, just mechanically, which bank does that count as in your samples?
So in here, that was at the beginning of 2011. And so the initial part, after the first part, it ends in 2010. So we don't have that part. And then the new shock is coming in 2012 Q1, in which Bankia is already Bankia. So now we take all the different 9 banks, which were Bankia, into one, because it's different periods. So we have these 2 different periods.